Can everybody find their seat, please? Find your seat. Find your seat, please, and be quiet. Welcome, everybody. We're here to honor a man, my dear friend, Richard Twiss, who passed away February 9th, 58 years old, way too young. He was the same age as me. Richard was born June 11th, 1954, and I was born June 16th, 1954. So we're here for Richard, for his family. So we're going to do a memorial song, and then we're going to grand entry powwow way like Richard always liked. He just loved to dance at powwows. I love to watch him dance. The day I heard he passed away, I was at a powwow with my fiancée, Charlotte. And I went and I bought this buffalo, this turquoise buffalo, and anytime I feel like sad for Richard or I miss him, I pick this up and I hold it and it reminds me of him and it makes me happy. So this I will probably cry happy tears. This I will cry sad tears because I miss him and I always wanted him to be here. But I'm happy that he finished well. He finished well. You'll never hear a financial scandal from Richard. You'll never hear of a mistress. Sorry, Catherine. And you'll never hear of some gay lover or anything like that. Richard finished his life well. And you don't know what to say at a funeral. You don't know whether to be sad or to joke. But I know that if I was gone and Richard was here in my place, he would constantly joke about me. And that would be appropriate because I'd enjoy that. So take that joking is in a good way as my respect for Richard. We're going to do a memorial song, and then we're going to do a grand entry song. So please stand at this time. Yeah. The memorial song simply states, you're not here anymore. You've made that transition. You closed your eyes in this dimension and opened them in another dimension. We don't fully understand that, but we know that Richard is on the other side, and we're happy for him. We're sad because he's not with us anymore, but we're happy that he made that transition. Simply stated, that's what the memorial song is. Please remain standing for grand entry song.
Ah!
I think some of you loved Richard from the turnout. We're going to do a flag song. We're going to post this Eagle staff. We're going to have one of our elders do a prayer. And then we're going to go into our memorial service for this great man. Richard was indescribable. He had a smile that lit up the world. He had a presence about him. You didn't need to know if he was in the room or not. You could feel his presence in the room. Just a very unique individual. Please remain standing for our flag song.
Bye. A ho ja te obnaží. Doke bilala huo. Ni tita ku yeki han chea o nichi lepelo. O tehi ke elo. Chea wa uelo. The words of the memorial song. One who stands with his people, where are you? Your family, your loved ones are crying, looking for you. This is a difficult time. Tungashila wakantaka. Taietu kihalela ke oapkewa. Otehika se eluhinesin pelo. Oyate nit hawakiha, makaki haleglakiha. Wichoni on yak upi. Na wichoni kiha he to hantuk teki slolung yapishni. Oganale hatu na ishihanis, seche. To hantuk teki ahe slolung yapishni chake. Unshit ea apeti ohila, woche keki ahegulha na unshipi. Oyate nit hawakiha. Taietu ki haleel wo te chiwa hinaji pelo. Hawaya te obnaji. Wana ni gilush taelo. Ga kia tukteel wo kinaji mekta ni tchao ya te. Hena kinaji puan hetia oyapcha. Today, you have joined our ancestors in that gathering place where you have prepared for your people. We grieve and there are tears in our eyes tonight, but we're glad that this warrior is Lakota. From the Sichangu Oyate has made it through. Thank you for his memory. Thank you. Uechetu lomitaki oyase.
Post the colors at this time, you may be seated.
Welcome everyone, once again, to this part of the memorial. Thank you so much, Brian Breakloud, who is Chiricahua Apache. Thank you for leading the beautiful ceremony, the grand entry, the posting of the colors. It was something that was very common to those of us who knew Richard and who got to hang out with him long enough. The powwow culture became very much a part of our love and our love to dance. And that was one thing that Richard all taught us, was dance your prayers. My name is Cheryl Bear. I'm Natlewetan First Nation. My village is located about 1,000 miles north of the Canadian border. We are commonly known as the Carrier People, but we call ourselves Dakel, the people who travel on the water. I'm from the Bear Clan. We say Danyendu, and we are people of the potlatch. I'm very honored to be able to call Catherine and Richard my dear friends. My husband Randy and I and our sons have got to hang out with them many times. Shared many stages and many late nights talking, me mostly with Catherine, because She's actually a lot more fun than Richard. I mean, really? Really? She is. I mean, I wouldn't stay up all night getting a bladder infection talking to Richard, but Catherine, yes, you know? So, there you go. No, we know Richard was a lot of fun. And the most eloquent speaker I have ever heard. Articulating scripture, articulating stories and humor, and drawing us all in and making us all feel like we were his dear friend. And always making us feel like we were included in his green room, didn't he? So before we get too far into the program, I would just like to recognize any chiefs or grand chiefs, hereditary chiefs, elders, tribal chairs, pastors and leaders. Can we actually have anyone who I have just called out? Can you please stand? We want to honor and recognize our leaders. If you're a leader of an organization or pastor of a church, if you are a chief, grand chief, hereditary chief, have a look around here, these beautiful people. So many beautiful people. Why don't we recognize them and give them a warm welcome? Richard Twiss always taught us that he was a follower of the Jesus way. So before I sing this prayer song, I'd like to read to you from John 14. Jesus is talking to us today, I believe. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's house. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I am going. And Thomas interrupts. Thomas is one of my favorite apostles. He says, no, we don't know the way, Lord. We have no idea where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to Creator except through me. This prayer song that I'm going to sing has the word Abba in it. It means Father in my language. And I believe it is so appropriate to call our Creator our Father, and even our grandfather, because the Lord certainly does have a grandfather's perspective and a grandfather's love for us, the love that some of us don't know yet, because we're not yet grandparents. But God has this love for us. Right, right. Chad is coming back and he'll be reading the eulogy.
Thank you. My name is Brian Brightcloud. I'm Chiricahua Apache, Fort Sill Band, Buffalo Clan, member of the Yellow Pollen Warrior Society. Let me take a few minutes and acquaint you with my friend Richard. Richard Twiss, Tayote Obnaji, he stands with his people. Passed from this life to the next, February 9th, 2013. Surrounded by his wife, Catherine, his sons, Andrew, Philip, Ian, and Daniel. Richard was 58 years old. He was my friend. Richard was born in the Rosebud Reservation, South Dakota, among his mother, Winona Larvey, LaPointe's people, the Sichanwu people of the South Dakota Sioux. Richard's father, Franklin Buster Twist, deceased, was Oglala from Pine Ridge Reservation. Richard was my friend. Until age 7, Richard lived in Rosebud, a town of 600 on the reservation in 1961. Richard's mom then moved them from the reservation to Denver, to Klamath Falls, and then eventually to Silverton, Oregon, where Richard attended the third grade to the 12th grade. Richard's mom ensured that they made regular trips back home in order to stay connected with her family and their culture. Richard was my friend. After graduating from high school in 1972, Richard moved back to Rosebud to enter Signa Gliska Spotted Tail College. It was there he became involved in the American Indian Movement. During this tumultuous time, Richard strengthened his connection with his relatives and deepened his appreciation for his Lakota culture. Richard was my friend. Richard wandered for a while, ended up in the island of Maui in Hawaii, where one night, alone in a deserted place, Creator responded to Richard's desperate prayer, making himself known to him. From that night in 1974 until his passing, Richard was on a spiritual journey to live a meaningful life as a Lakota follower of the Jesus way. Richard was my good friend. Richard met and fell in love with Catherine Crowish of Vancouver, Washington. Wedded her in 1976, Richard's proudest legacy, absolutely his proudest legacy, are his four boys. Andrew with his wife Diana, Philip, Ian and his wife Tony, and Daniel who has no one. He paid me $5 to plug his singleness. But knowing Richard, his greatest absolute would made his face light up were his two grandsons, Ezra and Leo. In February 1997, Richard and Catherine founded a nonprofit ministry called Wachoni International. Through Wachoni, Richard and Catherine touched the lives of, I would say, millions of people all across the world. Richard was also the co-founder of NAITS, North American Institute for Indigenous Theological Studies. He was the chairman of the board for My People International, member of the CCDA, Christian Community Development Association, and co-founder of Evangelism for Justice in 2012. Richard earned his doctorate, a DMIS, from Asbury Theological School. Until his passing, Richard continued his teaching career through NAITS program, Portland State University, and many, many higher schools of learning. Richard was my best friend. Richard's mother, Winona LaPointe, sisters Elaine and Lori LaPointe, nieces Stacy with her husband Mark, Melissa with her husband Tony, Jana and their children remain to continue his memory. His brother Tom passed before Richard in 2012. In lieu of flowers, the family has asked that you make a donation to Wachoni International. In the Lakota tradition, there is no word for goodbye. Instead, they say toshke'e, which means we'll see you later. To a son, to a husband, to a father, to a grandfather, a brother, and my best friend.
Lovely Hannah. We're going to have a song all the way from New Zealand. Of course, we know Richard and Catherine touched many lives all across the world.
mourning their sons. 500 years or so, the men are singing memories of the land. The sound of dancing comes, a symphony that echoes off the sun. Here's Lakota, here's home, visual poetry. A man of honor, a man of worth, pride and dignity. Let all creation lift up one voice as it was meant to be. Together, the Creator's masterpiece. Head held high, she beckons a new dawn. She sees the stars that lit the path her forefathers sailed upon. With trembling hands, her voice bursts forth with life, breathing a new song, a symphony that echoes off the sun. She is Māori, she is home, visual poetry. A woman of honor, a woman of worth, pride and dignity. Let all creation lift up one voice as it was meant to be. Together, here's Lakota, she is Māori, visual poetry. People of honor, people of worth, pride and dignity. Let all creation lift up one voice as it was meant to be. Together, the Creator's masterpiece.
We're going to hear from a series of speakers, starting with Joy.
Condense 30 years of friendship into just a few moments. I saw Richard just a couple months ago, and he had the biggest smile I'd ever seen. We were talking about his grandsons, Ezra and Leo. I met Richard in 1984 when my family and I stayed with the Twisses. We were considering a move to Vancouver, Washington, from Huntington Beach. After meeting Richard, Catherine, Andrew, and Philip, and his church, it was an easy decision. By July, we were here and a part of his family. In 1985, Otto Bass had a prophecy for Richard and our congregation. Otto told us, "You will look back one day and ask, is this our little Richard?" When the congregation grew from 50 to over 300 adults, we thought it was huge. And we thought Otto hit it. We didn't know Otto was talking about a much larger legacy. Richard and Catherine invited Dale and I to breakfast, and he asked me if I would consider being the church secretary. I said yes, and that was the start of an incredible journey. In addition to being my friend and my pastor, he was now my boss. His love for Catherine and the boys was so apparent. Many times he brought the boys to work with him. One of his sons was playing in the office, and Richard went downstairs to make a latte. When he came back up, his son was missing. So Richard asked me if I'd seen him, and I joked, and I said, "You lost him. You're such a bad dad." Richard stopped, and in a voice I had never heard before or after, said, I don't ever want to be a bad dad. It turns out Daniel had snuck into another room to play with some toys. Once a year, Richard would bring me several lists and ask me to mark the dates on his calendar. They were his son's sports schedules. It was important to him and Catherine to be at as many games as possible. At times, they'd attend two games in one day, or even Catherine at one game and Richard at another. He always shined at our annual church banquet, preparing for it, making sure all things were in order. The newsletters, financial statements, the banquet hall, it all had to be perfect. But what he never seemed to know was that the real highlight of the evening was Catherine. What was she wearing? And more importantly, what was her new hairstyle? Richard left the office to run some errands and came back much later than expected. He had found $200 on the sidewalk and went to a sale at Melvin's. Buy one suit for $99 and get the second for free. How many of you have seen him in a suit? His style of clothes may have changed, but his heart stayed the same. He had a vision for the church in Vancouver. He wanted it to be a multicultural church. There was one main problem as I saw it. At that time, Vancouver was a predominantly white town. But that didn't stop Richard. He adapted his vision and started taking church members with him on his annual trip to Rosebud. He also invited guests to our church like Garland Bruno and Jonathan Miracle. Because of the man he was, Richard was invited to places few could go. After he returned from Mongolia, he told me that while he was there, he recognized things he had taken for granted about the cross and Creator had no meaning to the people he talked with. He realized the traditional teachings he knew wouldn't work, yet he found a way to convey Jesus. Richard helped a sheltered little white girl see outside the four walls of her church and changed my perspective of the world. But look at this today. As his vision grew, he was no longer our little Richard, but he was one who saw the heart of the Father and followed the path he was given. I will miss you, my friend.
My name is Garland Bruno, and I am from the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs, and I'm a Wasco. My Indian name is Stowai. Daniel is the youngest of the boys, and when I met him, he was still in the oven. And that was the beginning of my friendship with Richard Twiss and Catherine and the boys. My family and I were taking a YWAM course in New Zealand, and I received a postcard. And on the back of it, it said, "Dear Garland, my name is Richard Twiss, and I met your friend, Denny Gunderson, and he's introducing me to you, so I'm sending me to you. I'm sending this postcard. When you get back to the United States, let's get together." So 2 years later, I call Richard and introduce myself over the phone, and then I explain that I wanted to bring my family to New Discovery Church. And I didn't want to get in the way. I just wanted to meet him, and I knew he was busy. And he said, "Oh, no. He said, you come over to the house afterwards and we'll talk." And that was in 1997. Now we're in 1989 when I'm at the church. And I go in, sit down with my family, and out comes Richard, three-piece suit on, short hair. And As I got to know Richard, I could see that he was struggling with something, but I wasn't sure what it was. We are now 3 or 4 years down the road, and Richard and I are on a plane coming back from the East Coast. And I began to think, wow, I've never told Richard that my mother was Chippewa Indian, and I wonder how they got along with the Sioux. So I sat there for a while on the plane, about another 30 minutes, and I went, okay, if we're going to be friends, he might as well know. And I said, Richard, I said, did I ever mention to you that my mom was from the Turtle Mountain Reservation in North Dakota and she was Chippewa? And he kind of put on a stony face, and he turned around and looked at me, and he just kept looking at me, and he says, I wondered what was wrong with you. He and I are now in Jerusalem together, and we're having dinner. And Richard begins to talk to me about this concept of Wachoni, but he didn't have a name for the ministry. He just had this idea in his mind. And we bantered and talked and shared, and I finally leaned back in my chair and I said, Richard, I really believe this is a ministry that God has placed in your heart, and it's something that you need to pursue. And pursue he did. And the next time that we were together, it was his first conference with, it wasn't called Wachoni now, but it was the context of what he was thinking about, and it was called the Five Streams, the Seven Streams. It was at our reservation, and about 50 people came, some from New Zealand, and we did the conference, and we were up in line, and we were getting ready to close it, and Richard was standing there, and unknowns to me, my wife had bought 2 hand drums, and Catherine said, Susan, go get the hand drums. So she went and got the hand drums out of the car, came up, a tug on my vest, and I opened my eyes, and here's my wife handing me a drum. And I see Catherine handing a drum to Richard. And my internal response, as we were standing in front of what I thought was a very large crowd, was, oh God, please don't let Richard drum the drum. Well, not being shy, Richard started to drum the drum. And at that moment, as I looked over to him, I saw something in him that he knew that he was on the right path. And something had broke, something had released in him. We are now months down the road. He calls me and he says, Garland, I have a name for the ministry. And I said, oh, okay, what is it, Richard? He said, Wachoni. He says, in my language, that means life. And I said, let me pray about that and I'll get back to you. So 3-4 weeks went by and I called him and I said, Richard, the name Wachoni is right on, but as I covered that in prayer, the Lord told me that you need to add on the end of that international, because this ministry is, you're going to be going all over the world. And so it became Wachoni International, and we're now going to do our second conference. I am meeting a dear friend of Richard's that he had met, Monty and Linda Ohia from New Zealand, and we were going to meet down in Los Angeles. And so we go down there, and I hadn't met Monty and Linda, and we're trying to decide where to have this conference. And I won't go through what happened there, but it was funny. And we discuss what we need to discuss, and I told them, I said, well, I don't know if this means anything, but I had a dream, and the dream was that there were these two pieces of land separated by water, and over this land were these long clouds, and Monty and Lindo Ohia looked at each other, and they knew, because in their culture, there are stories about the long clouds. So we knew it was going to be there, and it was held in Rotorua. And there was over 3,000 people that came. There's two significant things that happened there. One was that Richard and I think Terry LeBlanc was kind of like, wow, 3,000 people are here. And I believe that photograph is this where you see Richard and Catherine with their nose together. That photograph. And it was as if the two of them became one. I was watching that and I went, wow. And I was just so filled with happiness when I saw that. And the other one was that Monty O'Hea told me, he said, Garland, and the conference is over with, we're leaving, he said, you go home and peel potatoes with your people. The future of Wachoni is going to be great. It's going to be something I don't think even Richard would have expected. And it's going to take a lot of work, but all of the connections that we have here and people that couldn't make it are going to make a Wachoni and the message that Richard had in his heart just bigger than we've ever realized. I have this to say to my friend. I said, Richard, you will always be my friend. And I had a great, great love for you. And Richard, you will always, always be my friend. And as I ended my one-page talk here, I said, is there anything, God, that you would want to put in here that maybe Richard might want to say to us? And he took me to this scripture. My response is to get down on my knees before the Father, this magnificent Father who parcels out all heaven and earth. And I ask him to strengthen you by his Spirit, not a brute strength, but a glorious inner strength. That Christ will live in you as you open the door and invite him in. And I ask him that with both feet planted firmly on love, you'll be able to take in with all Christians the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience the breadth, test the length, plumb the depths, raise to the heights. Live full lives, full in the fullness of God. God can do anything, you know, far more than you could ever imagine or guess or request in your wildest dreams. He does it not by pushing us around, but by working with us. He spirit deeply and gently within us. Glory to God in the church. Glory to God in the Messiah, in Jesus. Glory down all generations. Glory through all millennia. Oh, yes, my friend. I love you.
Richard's looking down right now and saying, Terry, what have you done? You put Gary up on the stage. I'm Gary Foster. This is my wonderful wife, Jane, of almost 46 years. Richard was our friend. Wait. About when we met him.
When we first met Richard, we received a call from a friend in Colorado. A call from a friend in Colorado who said, I have a Native American man that needs to speak at a church next Sunday. Can you call your pastor and get him there? So we did. And we went and picked Richard up at the airport, and he stayed in our home. And people told us he never stays in people's homes. He always goes to a motel. But we had the privilege of having him stay with us. And it was love at first sight.
Yep.
He just just spoke to our hearts, and as time went on, we became part of the Twiss family. And I'll let Gary tell that story.
We met Catherine in March of 1999, right after we had met Richard, and we understood the connection, that Richard was complete to us at that point. They invited us down in June of 99 to go over some things about Wiconi. Richard had invited us in March to come on staff with them. We were looking for full-time ministry. And I'm out on the patio. Richard says, I got to clean a fish pond out. Can you give me a hand? So I climb in this fish pond, and I'm up to my knees bailing water and everything else with it. And Catherine comes out of the house and says, Richard, what are you doing? He casually looked up and says, this is a test. I'm seeing what kind of a servant's heart he has. That was Richard, my friend. Do you have any more you want to say? About the boys? Okay. We're nervous. We're servants. We carried Richard's bags and ran the office. We have never been up on the stage before. This is a first for us. And I'm just glad that the lights are bright.
Well, one of the things is we were servants to the servant, because Richard truly was a servant of Almighty God. But God put on his heart to reach indigenous peoples, and that's the path that he took. And I will say that one of my privileges, although it was part of my job, is I got to proofread articles that he was going to submit and his book that he wrote, and so I got first sight of wonderful, wonderful works that he did, and I counted that a privilege. And I actually got to also proofread his dissertation for his doctorate, and so that was a blessing for me to see those words on page before anyone else. Okay.
And speaking of books, the One Church, Many Tribes is all right, but I like 500 Years of Bad Haircuts myself. Yeah. Because it doesn't affect me, so. And Garland, I want to thank Garland. The first time I met Garland, we were in Maryland at a conference. I picked him up at the airport, and he said, Richard is a visionary. He's going to tell you five or six things because he thinks out loud. You got to figure out which one he means. Garland, Richard made it easy for me. The first thing he said when we landed and on the trips, all the trips we made, is find a Starbucks. That was Richard. One other thing is, I think that the boys really appreciated me. They really liked me. And I'm just taking a shot in the dark here. Before Jane and I came on, Richard used to be up at 2 o'clock in the morning in their house, because you got to realize that Wiconi was a 10 by 10 room at this time. And he would be at 2 in the morning with one of those tape machines where you're taping boxes. He'd be taping his own boxes to go on trips, and it would keep these guys awake. And so when I came on the scene, I would do everything in the office the day before he left, and I don't think they slept for a couple nights because it was so quiet. So, but that was Richard, my friend. One other thing, and I'm almost done, Terry. I promise I won't give an altar call here. Richard never had a bad word to say about anything, anybody. There's a lot of people that criticized him for the type of ministry that we all are involved with. And all he would tell me, you know, I'd get kind of in a wad, you know, because that's the Irish in me. And he'd say, that's the way they minister, this is the way we minister. In fact, some of the people that were saying these things, he would introduce me to them like they were his long-lost brother. I was a fly on the wall. I get to meet a lot of great, interesting people. And Richard, the Holy Spirit put us together, and it was only possible because of Richard and his wife and his sons. They make us feel like we're family. I know Richard would always say, all my relatives, like this. But Catherine and the boys and Richard made Jane and I feel like we were actually a Twiss when we came. And that was my friend Richard. One last thing. I don't know whether I ate too much for dinner last night or... But I thought I heard a voice speaking to me, and it said, "Gary, tell Brian Breitklot I'm glad he quit dyeing his hair." So, it could have been Richard's voice. I'm not real sure. So,
my name is Ganusinoe, Turtle Clan, Cayuga Nation, Six Nations Haudenosaunee Confederacy from Southern Ontario. Been a friend of Richard's since the late 80s. Kath and Boyce. Since his passing, each of us have gathered up every recollection of him that we could find. Some of us have found very old memories that had been forgotten in the busyness of our lives. One of the last photos Richards posted was a selfie in front of the BIA building in Washington, D.C. His anger against the white man and oppression brought him here in 1972. His love for his people and Jesus brought him back in 2013. He said on his own Facebook timeline that I had encouraged him to write about his 1972 experience. He had told many of us, but the story itself was not in writing in detail. I guess he was in the midst of doing that when he left us for good. His little smile in this photo is etched in my memory forever. To my knowledge, Richard only liked one thing on my Facebook timeline. Ever. It was the Bonhoeffer song, Skinny Love, that I had posted sometime in January. Jody then commented that this song streamed often at the Wachoni office, and everyone chimed in on the my, my, my part of the chorus. She then said that she could not, and others couldn't either, understand the lyrics. I then responded to her that the lyrics were like a Bob Dylan song. You can't really understand the song by the lyrics, but by the feelings or emotions they elicit. I told her that I understood or felt these lyrics from the broken side of love. It is this broken side of love that we resonate with. It was this broken side of love that was the crack in Richard's smile, and that was a sad in the twinkle of his eye. I live on this broken side of love, Richard, and thanks for your contribution to this. This too is etched in my soul forever. In reflecting on Richard's passing, I want to offer two theories. The first is, the more deeply you feel anything, the more you experience eternity. Each moment of deep pain is agonizingly long. Every moment of intense ecstasy smears out time so thinly that it disappears and seems to stand still. Our moments with Richard were like this. These emotional moments of laughter and joy in the times of agony of our people and of his life that we shared. It is these moments that each of us remember so well. My second theory is that Richard was and is a time traveler. He mastered these moments of intense feeling that made time seem to stand still, even just for a moment or two. It was long enough, however, to burn neurotraces that will last a lifetime. Some have spoken of Richard coming to them in dreams. Richard comes to me in moments of recall, sometimes triggered by context or something visual, or I hear something. I then transcend time and I am with him once again. He time travels to me to bug me again to tears and to trigger my regard. Ever so agonizingly slow, he will bug me less and less. And the tears and laughter will slowly subside. All of this will happen against my will. Come back, you bugger. Come back to those moments when our brokenness brokered our bond. Sitting here in Newburg, Oregon, in this coffee shop early yesterday morning. I'm missing you, Richard. I wish you were sitting here, just you and I alone, away from the crowds, away from the distracting din. Back and forth banter with no agenda, nothing to accomplish but the love of friends. Farewell, my dear Richard. Farewell, my dear friend. Practice your magic, practice your skill. Come to me in moments, come to me in feelings. Time travel to me and remind me still.
My name is Larry Anderson. My African American name is Larry Anderson. Now you, like I, know what the problem is. I'm here on behalf, first of all, of my friend and brother, Richard, but I'm representing his adopted family of brothers known as the Friday Group. Friday Group simply is a collection of men who have failed at life and are together in our collective fellowship being restored by God in the image of his son, Jesus Christ. I met Richard about 20 years ago. Remember Promise Keepers? Come to town and they were moving across the land and they wanted to reconcile the races. I was recruited by a friend of mine who's gone. And I first met Richard in several of those meetings. I have to confess, unlike many of you who have testified of his impact on you, I was indifferent to Richard because of my own pain. And I remember during a series of those meetings when I was sharing my pain with others in the group, Richard approached me afterwards and said, "Brother, I can connect with you as a native through the same oppression of that colonial spirit, evangelical oppression that has denied who you were so that you don't even understand your own culture in this country that your people built on their backs." And that's why my African American name that I do not know is X, as in Malcolm X. And when Richard told me that and reached out to me, my indifference responded by saying, That ain't my problem, man. I have neither the time or the energy to explore the issues around Native Americans. You go do that, and I'll do the black thing. Years later, as I was experiencing redemption, God spoke to me and said, "Find that man." And for several years, I began to inquire about this Richard Twiss. And one day I found him sitting at Starbucks right down the street from my house. And as I jumped out of my car and left it in the street idling, I met with his brother and I said, "Forgive me. I miss you. I want to know you." And our hearts at that moment, in the miraculous way that God does things, we became kindred spirits in a walk. And it was in that walk that Richard came to Friday Group and opened himself up and exposed himself to the men there, and we began to see the beauty that's inherent in the Native American experience through the gospel of his son, Jesus Christ. I love that man for that. As a result of that experience, we decided that we need to go together to other places, namely Washington, D.C. And we need to share the Friday experience that God gave us in Oregon on a national level in this country with our leadership. And it was at that moment, on about our fifth trip together, we were scheduled to participate in a seminar that had Andrew Young, which was an icon of the civil rights movement, sitting at our table during his last moments together, that my friend fell in battle. It was bittersweet for me. Finally, he was getting the recognition from the local leadership for everything that he had done. He was invited to the White House, a conference. He had recognition for the work that he'd done. People began to appreciate and recognize, even those other Native Americans like my own people. When I became a police officer who saw me as a traitor and I was not black enough for them and he was not Native enough for them, were at that conference the year before and we confronted them. When Richard shared his broken heart that some of his own people rejected him. And as he told me that at the table, it ripped me apart. And I said, "Brother, what do you want me to do?" And he thought for a moment. He said, "Let's go confront them." And we got up and moved right in the middle of the conference, and I got in their faces. And I said, "How dare you, after everything that we've been through, for you to act like this with this cat right here, who's my brother?" Because Richard had the degrees, but I had the intensity. That's why God put us together. But I want you to know what I know about my brother. On the day that he passed from this life to the other, I had to continue in the conference, and I wasn't able to be there as they were trying to revive him. And as I sat at that table next to Andrew Young, and I was receiving messages and updates about the condition of my brother, Andrew looked at me and said, "What is happening?" And I told him, and Andrew Young, U.S. ambassador, two-time governor, icon of Martin Luther King civil rights marches, right, the guy right next to him, gets on the stage and honors Richard Twiss, your brother. And he told us that this is a message for God for you to move on and do the great work. And I was encouraged. And that evening when I was at the hospital, Richard's spirit visited me quietly. And he said, bro, I'll see you later. But not now. And I knew at that moment that he was not dead. He was alive and in a better place. And that's what he wanted you to know tonight.
I wanted to start by acknowledging all of you as our relatives and family. My name is Nicole Maher, and I'm a member of the Tlingit tribe from Southeast Alaska. And I'm here today to honor Richard and his family and their memory. And it's really beautiful to see all of you here and all of the lives that he has touched from all over this world and all over this country. But my family and I know Richard as a friend and a community member. I live in Portland, and I served for 11 years as the previous executive director at NAIA Family Center. And that's how I got to meet Richard, as a community member who wanted to come and help and support young people and be involved in his backyard. He had been serving all over the country and all over the world, and he felt like it was time to come and spend some time with the local people. And what a blessing for us. We got to know him as a volunteer, as a servant, and it actually took me several years to know how important and recognized Richard was everywhere else, because we just knew him as our friend. Over the years, Richard then joined the NAIA Family Center board and became a prominent leader. And when we talked to him about joining the board, his one concern was, would he really get to hang out with the community and be friends with the staff and the community members, and would being on the board get in the way of that? And I love that story. It speaks so much about who he was. The other thing that so many of us loved about Richard locally was that even though he was so busy doing so many amazing things, he always had time to be a friend and a mentor, and particularly mentor young people in the community about how to be a husband, how to be a wife, how to be a parent, and how to be just a humble person. And he did it in the kindest way. And that's really what he was to my husband and I, and to our family and to our friends. And I just wanted to share that side of him that we as a family feel so fortunate to know. We feel so fortunate to know and love you too, Kath. And we're going to miss Richard, and so is our entire community. Thank you.
Nick Butchway, Chi Cook, Chi Nuxh Iwinan. Good day, my people. Good day to the loved ones that were left behind. He has not left you. He's here. A few years back, my name is Karen, I'm sorry. My name is Karen Jim Whitford. I am from the Celilo Indian Village, 12 miles east of the Dalles. My father was Chief Howard Jim. On both sides of my family, we have the strongest chieftainship along the Columbia River. And I'm one of the last 10,500 Yakima full bloods. I am a dinosaur. I'd just like to talk about how I met this nice man. Is Dale Wheeler out here somewhere? Right there. See, Dale? In our village, we waited over 50 years for the government to replace our homes. And I'm a cleaning fanatic, and our people are what do you call? I'm gonna go lay under the rock while you do all the work. And that's what happened to me. And Dale, I met him in Cascade Locks, and then he became good friends with my brothers. And through all of this, we had to clean the village. And we were, and Dale helped out get dumpsters and things. And then one day Dale says, "Well, Karen, my brother." And I says, "Huh? You got a brother?" And it was this man here. And I thought, "Are you two brothers?" And they're both laughing at me wickedly. And he says, "Well, they kind of mixes up. We kind of do some mischief things together." And so all of a sudden, a few of the people in the village came out to help. Little did I know who this man was. And I said, "Okay." You know, and so we were working so hard. We were smelling trashy and whatnot. And lo and behold, it was a good day. You know, God gives you a good day. And in our way, he is very happy. And he is very proud of you. And I pray the best for his journey. And among our people, all of us across the nation, he is now our elder. He is no more a child, a son. He is an elder to all of us because he earned that. He's got a happy journey, and it's going to continue in all of us here. Thank you.
On the next list of our speakers are the Minicons.
Before I start, I'd like to acknowledge the land that we're standing on, the Turtle Island people. I don't know the tribe, I'm sorry, but I just want to bring my respects to the elders and the ancestors, and thank you for allowing us to be on your country. And we just bring love and blessings from Australia. Sadly, Dad couldn't be here, Pastor Ray Minicon. He has a court hearing that he had to attend to back in Australia. So he's with my mother, Sharon, has left me to do the tribute to Uncle Richard Twiss. On behalf of the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island peoples of Australia, I first met Dr. Richard Twiss at the inaugural World Christian Gathering on Indigenous People in 1996 in Rotorua, New Zealand. This gathering was organized by another Indigenous Christian Maori warrior, Professor Monty Ohia. Meeting a host of other Indigenous Christians from around the world at this gathering was like meeting a long-lost family for the first time. Meeting Richard and his family was like meeting a long-lost brother. Through him and many other Indigenous Christian leaders, I soon discovered that many Indigenous Christians globally were struggling with the same issues, legacy and history brought about by fundamentalist Christian dogmas and doctrines, and brought to us by well-intentioned but misguided Western missionaries. We also discussed the fact that this historical and contemporary legacy and struggle was also compounded by the oppressive political, social, and economic history and ideology of colonialism that has left many Indigenous peoples crushed, landless, and we still continually abused racially, socially, and economically. We are left culturally bereft on the margins of modern Western society. We discussed at length the fact that we continue to find ourselves living in stark spiritual and social poverty and powerlessness in the lands of our respective ancestors. Richard, along with other Indigenous Christian leaders, brought these issues and burdens to the Rotorua gathering in 1996 and to other WCJP gatherings since 1996. The big question we began discussing globally was, how do we be authentically Christian and authentically Indigenous within our own cultural skin? How do we remain authentic with our now Indigenous identity within the political constructs and constraints of Western Christianity and Western society? These two questions are still an ongoing struggle and challenge. Richard met that challenge head on. I've watched and admired from down under. Richard's incredible passion and drive to bring these two questions to reality. Firstly, within himself. Secondly, through like-minded Indigenous Christian leaders. And thirdly, Richard challenged Western Christianity about Indigenous theology. To me, he will always remain an authentically Lakota Sioux warrior and an authentically Christian warrior. Richard's passion and power to transform and translate the message of Jesus and our Creator into an authentic, practical, theological, and philosophical Indigenous practice for all Indigenous people became his life work and legacy. In my personal reflection on his extraordinary life and ministry, Richard fulfilled the demands and characteristics of Psalm 1, 1 to 3. Blessed is the one who does not walk in the step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in seasons, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. In our central desert country here in Australia, we have a tree called the desert oak. It is one of my favorite trees because of its ability to grow in such arid and harsh environmental conditions. It is a remarkable tree because of this fact. Its roots can grow underground longer than the height of the tree above ground. The desert oak can look very small and fragile above ground. But underground, away from human sight, its roots will dig through sand, rock, gravel, and all types of obstacles until it finds the scent of water and moisture. Once it finds water, its growth above ground is exponential. It will grow so quickly that when fully grown, the desert oak offers shade, food, cultural tools and artifacts, and homes for all the animals, humans, and bird lives of the desert. The desert oak reminds me of my friend Richard Twiss. Through struggle, hardship, obstacles, and barriers, he found the deep spiritual and cultural water necessary to grow in global stature and significance, like a tree planted by the water. To indigenous Christians globally, living in our own spiritual, social, cultural, and political deserts. Richard was a desert oak that offered spiritual food to all indigenous Christians to be authentically Christian and authentically indigenous within our own cultural skins. He offered shade to those who felt confused about our indigenous identity and continually abused and bruised by colonial, political, and social forces and practices. He offered tools and artifacts from his own deep Lakota Sioux cultural roots that strengthened our resolve to be authentically Christian and authentically indigenous within our cultural skin and with our own respective communities and church denominations. This is quite an achievement by Richard in such a short space of time. What are the lessons and legacies of Richard's extraordinary life that has challenged us to reflect upon? Firstly, wisdom teaches us that if a raindrop falls into the ocean, it dissolves and disappears completely in an instant. But if that raindrop falls onto a flower or a leaf or of a desert oak, it nourishes the whole tree and produces life and growth. Richard taught us to be like that raindrop that falls on the indigenous flowers and leaves of the desert oak. Don't be like the raindrop that quickly dissolves or disappears among modern cultural forces that are alien to the traditions of our ancestors. Remain true and strong to your cultural roots and traditions of our respective indigenous tribes and peoples. Stand, fight, and struggle to maintain your cultural identity and dignity against all the powers and forces of colonialism and globalization that have forced our people to live in poverty and desolation on the margins of contemporary society that have become like desert places. Even in these places, we can follow the Jesus way and maintain their cultural identity and dignity that was given to us by our Creator. Secondly, a wise old Aboriginal man here in Australia once said that religion is for those people who believe in hell. Spirituality is for those who have been to hell. Richard implored us by a personal example that true Indigenous spirituality comes from deep within us. Our ancestors, our cultures, our heritage is a beautiful gift from our Creator. The roots of our culture are deep in our spirit and memory. We have a very important responsibility to preserve, maintain, and restore that which our Creator gave to our ancestors. It may seem like our communities and families are living like in hell holes, yet in spite of our social living conditions and political oppression in these desolate and destitute places, we have a deep cultural responsibility to stand proud and true to the cultural heritage given freely to us by the loving Creator. I reckon that these are some of the important lessons Dr. Richard Twiss encouraged us to learn and practice as Indigenous people. I pray with Richard and all Indigenous Christians that we can all be authentically Christian and authentically Indigenous within our own cultural skin and become like a tree planted by the water in our respective desert communities, like a desert oak. Thank you.
My name is Joanne Fuso. You have to excuse me, my voice has left me here. I feel very honored to be included among the people that are sharing words in honor of our friend and brother Richard Twiss. Richard seemed to appreciate the fact that I'm 100% Italian, and sometimes he would introduce me as a full-blooded Wapaho. And you might recognize Richard's sense of humor there. I first met Richard in the late 1970s in Alaska. We were part of the same church planting ministry, and Richard and Catherine, still newlyweds, were members of our church in Anchorage. I liked them right away, though the odds of us becoming friends seemed slim since I lived in California and was only in Alaska visiting. Over the years, I'd bump into Richard periodically at our organization's leadership conferences. the bumping in part being quite literal, since our most memorable encounters were on the basketball court, and Richard was a ferocious competitor. By the mid-1980s, Richard and Catherine had moved from Alaska to Vancouver, right here in Washington, where Richard became the pastor of a church. I was still living in California and had recently started a short-term missions agency called Forward Edge. I decided to contact Richard to see if he and Catherine would be willing to take a mission team to the reservation in South Dakota where he had spent his early childhood, the Rosebud Sioux Reservation. I was thrilled when he said yes. And for the next 3 or 4 years, he and Catherine returned to Rosebud with Forward Edge teams. In 1989, my wife Karen and I ended up moving from California to Vancouver, where we reestablished Forward Edge and joined Richard's church. For the first year, we even shared offices. Those were the days when Richard had his short hair and wore a suit on Sundays when he preached, before he took the leap into becoming fully himself. Over the years, the number of experiences we shared and ways we collaborated are too numerous to mention. Everything from skinning a buffalo on the Crow Reservation in Montana, we each took a bite of its heart, to arranging ministry trips to Oaxaca, Mexico, and Lhasa, Tibet. They couldn't figure out which Tibetan tribe Richard came from. But standing out among all these experiences were the times we just hung out together, whether on a golf course. And I have to say, Richard, I think his native skills came out on a golf course, because he would always know where the lost balls were. He would just disappear into the woods and come out with 15 balls. It was unbelievable. The times we just hung out together, whether on a golf course, at a local pub, or in one of our homes. And since Richard and Catherine's home was just a mile down the road from ours, those times were often spontaneous and easy to make happen. What I treasured and will always miss about those times was the way we came together with such a natural appreciation and respect for our shared history, our ability to be fully ourselves, and our easily maintained commitment to loving one another, even when we disagreed. My Irish wife, Karen, in fact, was one of the few people on earth who could get full on into Richard's face, usually in an effort to get him to appreciate Catherine more, in a way that only deepened our friendships and increased our love for one another. Like many of you, I considered myself one of Richard's best friends. That seems to be part of the legacy of generous, big-hearted people. They leave others feeling like their friendships are somehow closer, more special, more intimate than the friendships they have with others. Knowing Richard was like sharing the journey of life with a kindred spirit, a fellow pilgrim who knew something about himself and others, but never stopped learning, growing, asking questions, and cherishing what he knew was more important than his public success, his family, and his friends. As a son, husband, father, friend, Richard cannot be replaced, but he will be remembered with a quiet sting that reminds us how much we miss him and how much fun it will be when we see him again. And I want to close by just sharing a word that I believe God gave me just yesterday on the Oregon coast, and it's for his boys. And I really believe God put this on my heart. You know, like you guys, I grew up in the shadow of a father who seemed larger than life when I was growing up. It was very intimidating to me, and I felt this pressure to somehow live up to who my dad was. And what I believe God put on my heart to share with you guys is that he knit each one of you in your mother's womb. Every day ordained for you has been written in his book before one of them came to be. And that as you keep trusting him, as you keep fixing your eyes on Jesus and running with perseverance, the race is marked out for you. You will honor God. You will honor your father. You will honor your mother. And that's the word God gave me for you. And I believe it's from his heart.
I want to thank Catherine and the Twiss men for allowing me to speak about my friend today. My name is Randy Woodley. I'm a legal descendant of the United Ketua Band of Cherokee Indians in Oklahoma. They say only love can break your heart. Since I first got the news of Richard's heart attack, like you, my heart has been broken. But it also feels like my whole life has been broken, or like one of my legs has been cut off. Richard's Lakota name was He Stands With His People, but there were many ways that Richard helped me to stand. We began with phone calls 16 years ago and emails when that first became possible. And after we got to know each other, we were both very critical of each other in our approach to Native American culturally contextual ministry. He thought I was a syncretist, some of you know what that is, and that I was imprudent. I don't think he ever came up with that word. I just found one to kind of capsulize it. I thought he was doing culture without proper rites and protocol. And it turned out we were both partially right and partially wrong. And I guess some might say at first we were not quite friends and not quite enemies. I think they have a word for that now, frenemies. Yeah. But as often is the case, we found out that on this big journey that we were on, that we would need each other. And it would be a lifelong journey for both of us. When I think of our relationship, two verses from Proverbs come to mind. One is, a man of too many friends comes to ruin, but there's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. The second, the wounds of a friend are trustworthy, but the kisses of an enemy are excessive. I simply wanted to be Richard's friend, and I was fortunate enough to count myself as one. Some of you may have, I know some of you have, heard Richard and I verbally slug it out from time to time, and were amazed that we could remain friends. I think our relationship and that little band of brothers that we had often saw the reality of the worst in each other. And by confronting it, sometimes through humor or ridicule or sometimes in anger, it eventually brought out the best in each other. Much of that speaks to the grace Richard gave me and others in his life. He understood loyalty and friendships. And as critical as we could be of each other, when it came to it, Richard, after a while, understood that I and a few others had his back regardless. And I knew he had mine. Richard stood with his people, but he also gathered his people. And just look around you right now. Look, this is not a rhetorical statement. Look around you. He's still gathering us. I believe this gift, the gathering gift that he had, will continue and bear much fruit, especially through the young people's lives he personally touched. He once told me that he didn't have the heart of a pastor, but I saw something different. I saw the deep passion he had for young people, those young lives that he touched. Those ones he called nieces and nephews, of true concern and care. And I just wondering if some of those are here, just to let folks know, would you stand up if you were one of those young people that Richard touched and called nephew or niece? Go ahead, stand up. All right, let's give them encouragement. Thank you. I hope that you have the courage to follow your dreams in the communities that God has put you in, and I hope you will have each other's backs. Richard has to be understood also as part of a close team of brother friends that eventually became NAITS, the North American Institute for Indigenous Theological Studies. He was an incredible team player. And as NAITS community developed and matured and our theology and perspective, so did Richard. even though it may have appeared often from the outside when he was up there speaking that it was all about Richard. Nothing could be farther from the truth. Although we didn't tell him that. We would always say, oh, it's all about you, right, Richard? But we knew. We knew better. It was not that way at all. He always promoted the movement and the community above himself. And that's something you boys need to know. In this regard, he was generous and thoughtful and understood his own giftings and his own limitations as well. He knew about the giftings and limitations of us all. And it may be very difficult for some Americans to understand in such an individualistic society and a persona-driven church how our little native community works so well together. In our Indian way, individuals move the ideas of the group forward because they're secure in the group's identity. To try and understand Richard Twiss as a man who was just interested in building himself up in a ministry is a completely wrong picture. To try and understand Richard Twiss apart from his Native American community is a misunderstanding as well. Maybe this is the greatest lesson Richard still has to teach us. He was a community builder. He loved to gather us together because this is where our strengths lay, together. And for that small group who grew up together in this battlefield called Contextual Native Ministry, he was our golden boy, the voice and charisma and fantastic communicator for our movement and for our community. I often told people that Richard was not just the best communicator in Indian country, but one of the best I knew, period. I would often see our group's ideas, which he borrowed liberally, amplified and universalized in his big tent communications. And we love that. That was the gift that we will sorely miss. Richard was an incredible innovator in our movement. In his closet, as his closest friends, we understood what he was accomplishing as the Spirit moved through our indigenous people. No one else could do what Richard was doing better than Richard. His unique giftedness was his extroverted personality and his innovative mind, which was like a sponge. He soaked up new information, then was able to communicate it in very easy to understand and humorous ways. His framing on the subjects we all batted around for decades was unique and refreshing. His humor allowed him to get by with subject matter that most of us could not. He had folks laughing and bleeding simultaneously. You felt that, right? Even though as a group we had many knockdown, drag-out fights over the years, he also kept us laughing at ourselves. And Richard was always willing to reconcile. After a while, it just became normal for us all to fight and love without holding grudges for too long. Much of that was because of his influence and his generous spirituality and his jovial demeanor. In the past several years, I saw Richard really hitting his intellectual and integrative pace. Like a fine runner, he had so much more to give and to speak and to write about. I think he was in the bloom of his career in terms of his message and developing a worldwide platform with it. Now it will all be done in another way, but still through Richard's influence. Like he did with some of you, Richard always greeted me with a kiss, no matter how long it had been since I saw him last. A kiss on the cheek every time we saw each other. So I can't say goodbye, but Richard will always be a part of my thoughts and always a part of my life. So I'll just say, see you later, buddy. And here's my last kiss.
My name is Terry LeBlanc. I'm a Mi'kmaq from the Listigouche First Nation in the province of Quebec in Canada. I too was Richard's friend. A better friend than Brian. I needed to do that. It's just been rising up in me since Brian was up here. I'm not the humorist that Richard was. I like to think I was. But when Richard and I started out in the trail of ministry together 20-some years ago, we both suffered from an affliction. It was the affliction of young men. It's called ego. We tried really hard to hide it from our wives and our friends, our other friends, but I'm sure it was obvious for all of them to see. We just wanted to do well, and we just fell into it. Try as we might to set it aside, each of us were honest with one another on nights when we would be back at the hotel, motel, or elsewhere and say, you know what? And we'd share a little story about our ego. We struggled with it, especially as we realized some years later that people had an interest in what we had to say. I remember us being back after conference and saying to one another, imagine that. Imagine that. People actually came to pay something to hear us. They had an interest in what we had to say. Imagine that. We tried to have the best stand-up routine that we could, but as Brian Breitkleb would make clear to any of you if you were to ask him, in my case, he would say it didn't work very well. So finally and ultimately, I had to admit to the small gathering yesterday that it had become clear because of Richard's raw talent, sharp wit, and engaging personality that I was indeed, as his mother Winona had noted, the straight man. That's just my role. She called us Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis, and she never did say who was who, but I'm pretty sure I knew. Richard's incredible persona and commanding presence ensured that in the years ahead, he would be an amazing and widely acknowledged spokesperson and prophet among us. And I think you've heard that from many people here this afternoon. For those who would listen behind their preconceptions to the issues that Richard addressed, his message was transformative. It challenged people's reading of history as well as the contemporary version of their acceptable reality for the church and wider society. Although his boys and my children would say of each of us over the years that we only ever had one message, no matter what the venue, and that was probably true, Richard was able to nuance the core of his thinking well, I think better than anyone, and present his prophetic vision to diverse audiences around the globe as if it were fresh each and every time. As his insights were honed further through the years of his doctoral work, he became an incredibly potent force for just action and right thinking about how to be a human being and a follower of the Jesus way in more than Sunday church. In the later years, about how to be a common man. And he was in these past years trying to help us to become common men and women. There were people who thought they knew Richard, but as you have seen with the people who have spoken here today, Richard was not easily captured with simple words about his identity or his heart for people or his relationships with people. He was complex. He was open. He was engaging. He was genuine. He was welcoming of all people. But there are people who simplified what Richard was saying and thinking and who he was as a person, particularly in recent years. People who nonetheless missed the essence of Richard and his message. Many in the evangelical conservative church, for example, who opposed his messaging of the good news of Jesus for indigenous people within culture. They believed he promoted culture over Jesus. These were the folks who often swallowed the camel of Western culture, even as they strained at the gnat of Indianness. Richard was quick to point this out to them and to us. Then there were those who, while they embraced Richard's message of the Creator's embrace of indigenous culture, set aside the Creator's son, Jesus. Oftentimes, the hurts of the past made it difficult for them to see Jesus as simultaneously unique and yet fully universal. For Richard, Jesus was a two-legged. He was of olive skin. He honored his parents. He held to tribal customs and protocols while simultaneously challenging their legalism. And yet he was nonetheless the full presence of the Creator among the creation for the Maori, the Lakota, the Swiss, the French, the British, and yes, even the Italians. Joe, it's always been a comfort to me to know that good Italians played Indians in the old movies. In my years with Richard, neither of these perspectives was what he strove to say or be. Those who thought he was trumping culture over Jesus did not see the vibrant embrace of Jesus that was evident in his life. Even during times where those of us who knew him well listened to him struggle, talking out his theology even before he'd thought it all the way through. He was like that. He just wanted to talk about what he was thinking. He wanted to put it out there and let people hear it, have it bounce back, and have him refine it. And he was incredibly good at it. He was a sponge. He took all my good ideas. Jesus was central as Richard's example and hope. Those who thought Richard spoke of cultural forms and traditions as equivalent to the person, work, life, teaching, death, and resurrection of Jesus did not see the continued commitment in Richard's life and thinking that anyone or anything that took the place of Jesus was unacceptable. In his forthcoming work, Rescuing Theology from the Cowboys, only Richard could come up with those kinds of titles. 500 Years of Bad Haircuts and Rescuing Theology from the Cowboys, that's Richard Twiss at its best. Richard said this. He said, as indigenous scholars, now here's something. Right to the very end, Richard did not conceive of himself as a scholar. And yet I want to say to you, there was no one of sharper intellect, a more refined wit, a greater capacity to grasp the complex, a more well-read and well-studied individual than Richard. Now, I've got far more degrees than Richard. I got them coming out the wazoo. But Richard was one of the sharpest intellects you will ever know. He could do stuff in his head that I just couldn't imagine. As indigenous scholars, he said, we fully embrace the dynamic tension in making Creator's story known in language that speaks to a particular audience and in the process does not take away from the uniqueness of Creator in Christ and the work of the Great Spirit in the earth. This is the Richard I know, and I say no, not new. I say no because it's me who struggles with his death today. It's me, it's you that struggle with death today, not Richard. See, it's you and me who are here today thinking about death and our loss of his presence among us. Richard, on the other hand, is continuing the journey we've all been set on by the one who made us, as we exited our mother's womb, or as Dr. Jerry Yellowhawk spoke last night, while we were being formed and fashioned by the one whose idea it was to bring us into existence. We are the ones who struggle with death. This is not Richard's issue, it's ours. This is the Richard I know. I know him still. I know him because we shared the stories of him yesterday and today. Some of them, a few of them. I know him as alive because he embraced the promises of the one who made him. Richard has moved from life to life, from a life that carried the pains and sorrows and challenges of a creation awaiting its full restoration, to the place where that restoration originates, the place of our Creator's residence in what many of us call heaven. Some years ago now, in the week that followed a Calgary Many Nations One Voice in Calgary, Alberta, Canada, many who were able to come after the conference in the week that followed came to our home out on the land that we had settled in on, my wife Bev and I. And there we put up all kinds of tents and teepees, and there were campers and trailers of all sorts as people from all over North America came to hang out together. We had a little bit of a mini powwow. We held camp and celebrated some life together. We fished and golfed, and gosh knows, Richard loved golf. Our spontaneous powwow consisted of all of these tents and teepees and wigwams and wickiups and all the things that you could imagine for dwelling in, including our living room floor. But they were all temporary dwellings. And as the people who had come to visit us had finished with the visit, as we'd finished our time together, they packed up, folded up, and took away those tents, those campers, those teepees and wigwams. And they made their way to their more permanent homes. Well, that's what Richard has done. He's packed up his teepee. The Apostle Paul said something in the Bible many years ago that placed this whole thing about moving from life to life in perspective for me when he noted this. We know that when these bodies of ours are taken down like tents and folded away, they will be replaced by resurrection bodies in heaven, God-made, not handmade, and we'll never have to relocate our tents again. Sometimes we can hardly wait to move, and so we cry out in frustration. Compared to what's coming, living conditions around here seem like a stopover in an unfurnished shack, and we're tired of it. We've been given a glimpse of the real thing, our true home, our resurrection bodies. The Spirit of God whets our appetite by giving us a taste of what's ahead. He puts a little of heaven in our hearts so that we'll never settle for less. So you see, we're the ones who are experiencing death here today, not Richard. He's now packed up the tent of his earthly dwelling among us, and he's moved home to that place we will journey to, all of us, in the days ahead as we move from life to life. It's we who have yet to be translated into the eternal, to what we imagine of heaven. And by the way, I think of that as different than the fluffy white clouds and angels singing Hillsong. I think it's a big difference from what we think about it and what it really is. And I think Richard is enjoying golf. I don't know what heavenly golf looks like, but and probably smoking a heavenly cigar and maybe having a heavenly IPA. So Richard is there. He has gone from life to life, and we're here today to struggle with death. It's not Richard's struggle, it's ours. And what we wanted to do is, as Catherine and Andrew and Philip and Ian and Daniel, and their lovely wives, Tony and Diana, grandkids, Ezra and Leo, Mom Winona, Lori, Ted, everybody that's here, as we thought about what we wanted to do, we wanted you to experience how incredibly impacting the life of Richard Twiss has been. From all of the various speakers and all of the complexity that was Richard. And so everyone who's spoken here brought some small portion of the story of the life of Richard Twiss to you. And so we celebrate that life as we move from life to life.
At this time, we're going to ask the Twiss family to come up and share. Yes, all of you guys. Go your own way, Daniel. Ian. Not sure where Ian's going.
Hello. I'm pretty sure everybody in this room is every person that I've ever met. It's kind of incredible to see everybody here. But I just want to, before I say anything, acknowledge one person who's actually been an absolutely amazing human being through everything that's been going on, and that's J.R. Lilly. I've never met a more outstanding human being who's so young and well. But I prepared this, spent a lot of time on it, about 5 minutes before we walked up here, so. I just want to tell a story a bit where Dad really helped me out in my journey. I was at one of the world gatherings in Jerusalem, and it's where Dad actually introduced me to God. It was, we were sitting by the Jordan River, and everybody was getting baptized, and people were jumping in, diving in, cannonballing, getting ready to get baptized. And I didn't want to go. It wasn't something that I wanted to do. Never been baptized, never, you know, I don't know, just didn't want to do it. But I took everybody's stuff. I started, oh, you going in? No, let me hold your shoes. Let me hold your camera. Let me hold your purse. Let me hold your... So I had all this stuff, just all this junk in my hands. And so Daddy came up and he said, do you want to go ahead and jump in? Oh, I got all this stuff, so no, I'm fine. And Dad did what Dad does best, is he just kind of looked at me and he goes, oh, yeah, okay, excuse me. And he started to delegate. Grab other people and like, oh, can you hold this? So little by little, all this stuff was coming out of my hands, and then I had nothing left. And so I took my shirt off and I went in my jeans, took my shoes off, and I went in, and basically all my brothers who I've grown up with in the gathering, a lot of good people, Uncle Terry, Matt, just some really good family members. They took me down, they brought me back up, and it was funny because me being a thick-headed fella, he came up and started crying, and I started hugging my dad, and my thoughts were not this profound thing. It was actually, this is it? Aren't I supposed to, like, see things now? I don't know what's going on. But, and then that's when Dad introduced me to God, is because God was just like, man, shut up. Man, I took you all the way to New Zealand and all the way to Jerusalem, and I've introduced you to all these people, and you're here crying in your arms, Dad. Like, what more do you want? Like a dove to come down and land on you and say, this is my good son, and I'm deeply pleased. So God told me to shut up. And but that was Dad. I mean, Dad would always come to me, for me. He would always come, and he would meet me where I was at. He wouldn't try and compartmentalize, do that Western thing of just breaking somebody down and then putting them in a box so that they can now clearly judge and define what it is. He let you be human. He let me be he. Be me. Hold on, let me try that again. He would let me be me. And that's what I needed more than anything, just to be me and let me do a thing. He wouldn't try to put me in that box and fix me. And he was the man who would just sit and journey with me through all of this stuff and be the thick-headed dummy that I sometimes am. So that's what Dad taught me to do, and he taught me how to journey well, and I'm gonna continue to do that.
I'm his other son, Ian. This is Ezra. If he could talk English, he'd say hello. This is my wife, Toni. So one of really great quote out there is, passion is the genesis of genius. And my dad, he was a freaking genius to me, you know? Duh. So, you know, a lot of us in this room, we were his passion, and he had a love for all of us, and that's why we're here. But I know deep down in my heart that I was one of his deepest passions, you know? And I think for a son, there's no better thing to know than your dad had a lot of passion in life, but, you know, you were in the very top. And he got to be in the room when Ezra was born. So when Ezra came out, you know, my dad and I, we hugged, and it was like we were the babies, you know? We were just crying and sobbing. And my dad had terrible vision in his later years, so he did a dad hug, so he'd have to, like, put you back to be able to see you good, you know? And so he did the thing, you know, it's like... But in the moment, it's like, yeah, that was freaking awesome. I just had a son, and he didn't get to spend nearly enough time with Ezra. But I know that, you know, right after my mom, Ezra was in the top two of his passions. And that's what really drove his life. And so it's like, I just feel so lucky that, you know, I got to call him Dad. You guys all call him friend and brother, but I have this distinct honor of Dad. And that was really freaking cool, too.
Really tall up there. He couldn't even give me enough jeans to be taller than he was. But I do feel fortunate enough, though. I think he finally did, because I'm wearing his boots right now, and they gave me just that little much. So I'm happy to wear his boots, though I'm not trying to walk in his shoes, because that's just an impossible path to follow. But as I was thinking about my dad, I thought of a few quotes. They say, home is where the heart is. And he had the ability to put you at home wherever you were. And I just loved talking to him on the phone, because every time I missed home or I missed anything like that, I was instantly home, just over the phone. And as many of you know, he had that ability with you. He could make your own house feel more like your own home if he was there. Stand up. And the other one is, I got it written down here. Home is wherever I'm with you. And a lot of you got to experience that. I did a bit. Home is wherever you are with him. So it could be on a plane, an airplane, that's your home, because you're with him. Because you had his heart wherever you were. You always had his heart, and he always gave his heart to you completely. He was never, you know, there's never a conversation where he's just trying to think of what he's going to say next. He fully listened. And that's why he was able to speak so well, is because he listened. And then he did have the ability to speak last, and a friend of mine came up with the phrase speeching. He didn't just talk to you about anything. He listened to you so intently. You shared your hearts. And then at the end of that, he would speech. I'm sure a few of you got that. So yeah, it's a great honor to be his son, and I've cried a lot over the last month, and I'm sick and tired of it, but I look forward to crying more and more tears when I remember him, and he's a great man, and I look forward to remaining his son for the rest of my life.
I'm Andrew, I'm the oldest. This is my wife Diana, and this is Leo. Lots of energy. It's nice to be here as we are all celebrating the life of Richard Twiss, and how these past few days have had the opportunity to hear people's stories and stories and stories and jokes and experiences, and just really realizing how amazing this guy Richard Twiss is and was. Because for me, as amazing as he was an even better father. He was my dad. And so, as the oldest, just trying to figure out, which I've given up figuring out the why, there's no why, but just being the oldest in that sense of what's next, because he was such a big personality and he was such an amazing guy. And at our house, Diana is very much like my dad, and they would save everything. And so if there was an open space, you wouldn't clear it off to make room, you would just move your stuff. And so I throw everything away. And so I'm trying to come up with a memory. Do I have a note? Do I have a this? And she comes in and she drops this card on the table, which was amazing, but now I can never throw anything away ever again, because she saved this one thing. And so trying to think of, like, putting this pressure on myself that I know is unjust and unfair, but the card kind of said it all, and he said, you don't have to be anything but 100% you. You don't have to fit, you don't have to follow any formula or fit any definition except the one that's right for you. And he said, as my father, how blessed and filled with pride to see me growing into the remarkable father and partner with Diana. And just that idea of being 100% you, which I think he challenged all of us to do and be, the concept and the word that he used, that ikje wichasha, to be the common man. And so I don't have to be anybody. We don't have to be anybody other than who we are. And may we all strive to be that common man.
All right, so next up is going to be a song. We played this song as we gathered in Washington, D.C., just after he passed. And so if you can cue it up, I'm going to just go ahead and set it up a little bit. All right, so we shortened it just a little bit. So this first verse, I'm just going to read. So, how many times have you heard someone say, if I had money, I would do things my way? But little they know that it's so hard to find one rich man in 10 with a satisfied mind. And so this song really struck deeply with all of us because we knew that he didn't leave anything unsaid, not to us, and he left this world truly with a satisfied mind.
Jerry Yellowhawk. Good words, guys. Good words. Jerry is going to give us the closing prayer. Then we're going to have the honor song, some concluding words, and a final song and dance.
The words are, I am sending my voice. Send your voice to me. Pray to me, and I will answer what you ask for. From the Lakota Sioux language. Oh, yeah, monkey, I Che maki ayo, ho ye maki ayo, che maki ayo, hey o hey. Takul ihek o hey, hey e che tuk de lo. We chonik de yelo, che maki ayo, ho ye maki ayo, yani bi de lo, yo, ayo, ayo. Aho. Haoyate obnaji. Aho. Haoyate obnaji. Aho. Haoyate obnaji. Aho. Haoyate obnaji. Aho. Taki o yase eche tuala.
I'm gonna call on Brian Brightcloud. During the honor song, we are going to have a retiring of the regalia. Need some help up, Brian?
Thank you.
It was hard watching that regalia go. You know, I hope to see it again someday. Thank you to everyone who participated in today. Thank you for all of the elders. Thank you to the drum team for directions. Drum group, you guys are amazing. And you're here because you were one of Richard's favorites. So thank you for honoring him. And Vincent Ild, old woman, for joining at the drum. Thank you to everyone who spoke. Yeah, let's give them a hand. You can all be seated for another minute. I'd like to close with some of Richard's own words. Richard wrote these to my husband Randy and I. Over Christmas, our family was holding vigil at the deathbed of our beautiful daughter-in-law, Melissa. And I was writing to them and telling them how I felt, the injustice of it all, and just sharing honestly. One of our dear elders who's here, Fern Noble, she said years ago, the Native people were good at death because it happens a lot, but we need to get good at life. And I like it that Richard was really good at life. His boys shared so eloquently how he was. So after sharing these about the injustice and so on, and just going through this experience, a very long goodbye to Melissa. She passed away at the age of 32 on January 20th. Catherine and Richard, so sweetly, as they always do, they sent us a condolence card. So I'm going to finish with these words, the last written words from Richard to me as he was sharing about death. Though seemingly impossible to make sense of part of the circle of life, our hope is real in Jesus, who is real. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Twiss family, for sharing him with all of us. And the last item on today's agenda, boy, I never thought I would say those words, is that we're going to have a song by another favorite of Richard Twiss, and that is a Michael Jacobs song. So once again, thanks for coming out. On behalf of the Twiss family, on behalf of Richard's beautiful mama, Winona, and their loved family, I just say thank you. Thank you for showing the support that you have to the family. Thank you for showing your support to Wichoni over all of these years. I would like to say that Wichoni is not over. It's you know, when we have a death, a lot of times it signifies a new beginning. And I think that this is a new beginning. I've always admired Catherine Twiss, and I've got to be honest, the first Many Nations One Voice I ever went to, I didn't hear Richard, I didn't hear Ray or Adrian. I heard Catherine. She was the main speaker at the first, one of the original, earliest Many Nations, and she is one of the most eloquent speakers I have ever heard. She articulated so clearly the vision of Wichoni, and Wichoni carries on strong. So I would like to appeal to you, to those of you sitting here in this room, to those of you who are watching live streaming, to please continue to give to this ministry. Continue to give to Wichoni, because it is a growing organization and it is needed on this planet. We have a lot more work to do, don't we? We have a lot more work to do. So now we're going to close with the song by Michael Jacobs, and I believe that we're going to have some beautiful dancers. Terry, do you have any last words? Come on up. Are you going to speech?
I'm not going to speech. I'm just, because you're getting old, I know your memory has failed, so this this dance is... We selected the song. It was one of Richard's favorites and one of Kath's, and it's titled Welcome Home, Michael Jacobs. We've used it many times over the years in a dance, an Eastern Woodlands dance called the Transformation Dance, otherwise known as the Snake Dance. And it talks about moving from life to life, and we thought it was a very appropriate way to conclude our time. So it's a dance that's not a spectator sport, but the invitation is for you to come and to participate with us in this dance that Jacob and Jody Treviso are going to lead us in to the song, Welcome Home.
Everybody dance.
It's been a long time, a long time we've been apart. But my relations, the grieving has passed. A song of joy fills our hearts. Welcome home, welcome home, welcome home. Loved ones, welcome home. We are, we are here. We are, we are here. We are, we are. We are welcome home. I said, welcome home.
We are, we are here. We are, we are here. We are, we are.
We are welcome home. I said, welcome. Welcome home. Children returning from faraway lands. Mothers and daughters, fathers and sons. Generations returning from the four winds. Brothers and sisters, we're all here as one. Welcome home, welcome home, welcome home, my loved ones, welcome home.
We are, we are here, we are, we are here, we are, we are,
we are.
We are, we are here. We are, we are here. We are.
said, welcome home. I said, welcome home. I said, welcome home. I said, welcome home. Yeah. I said, welcome home. I said, welcome home. Yeah.
All right, if you want to make your way, those of you who are wanting to dance, the drum's going to play a few more songs, but for those of you who would like to get some coffee, tea, and there's some light cookie kind of stuff out there in the back at the tables, just in the other part of the building, please feel free and carry on the conversations that you've already started out there. Thanks again on behalf of Catherine, Andrew, Diana, Philip, Ian, Tony, and Daniel. Thank you very, very much for